we are here this afternoon because all of us know, very definitely know, that there's something wrong. There's something wrong personally, and there's something wrong worldwide. Something wrong with me, you, as an individual. Something wrong with countries, with cities, with communal groups. There's something wrong with human beings, any way you look at it. Now, why are we here today instead of down at the beach or watching the ball game on TV? It's because perhaps we have come to this at least elementary sensing of something dreadfully wrong, which can't be ignored anymore. The nagging is just too persistent. And 1,000 football games or 1,000 visits to the beach or the mountains or vacations or making $1 million or getting a new girlfriend or boyfriend or husband or wife, all those things can't possibly drown out the ache. It is there. It's pressing on us, driving us half crazy, not being able to find any answers to it at all. Now, let me say something very simply as I can put it. No emotion about it at all. No fancy words about it at all. If you are now unhappy, you can be happy. If you are divided, if you have 50 people inside you, you can have just one person inside of you, one whole person inside of you. If you don't know what you are all about, or what life as a whole is all about, you can know right here on earth what you and life are all about. In order to reach this new understanding, great, enormous, unending sacrifices have to be made. And it is the reluctance to give up something, to indeed make these sacrifices, that prevents us from finding this other life I'm telling you about. Now, I want you to listen carefully to what I'm going to tell you next regarding sacrifices. I just said it was necessary to sacrifice many, many things, which we'll go into detail later. Because the booting out of the unnecessary makes room for the necessary. So we're trying to make room for it. But we don't want to sacrifice things inside us, our thoughts, our ideas, our convictions, our self-wills, our prides, our vanities. We don't want to sacrifice our negativities, which is all that's required of us, because we think that that will result in a nothingness, because we identify with everything negative inside us. How many of you are very sad at times? Huh? How many of you dejected? Mm-hmm. How many of you get jealous? How many of you have rage in you? How many of you, well, boy, we got a mess out here. Now, all of you raise your hand on this next one, mechanically or any other way, as long as you raise it. How many of you feel cheated? You don't even know who's cheated you, do you? Do you? You don't know who's cheated you, and yet that doesn't make sense. Something has cheated me. We don't even know what. I'll guarantee you have been cheated, but it's a different thing that you can imagine. Our own delusions have cheated us. The reason I brought up and asked you to participate with me in a confession of negativities is because that will be a starting point for you understanding something which will be the end of the negativities and therefore are truly authentically new inner life for you, which will affect your outer life very, very favorably. If all you have is your sadness, which is all people, don't say you're happy when you get a birthday gift. You're just excited. You're the center of attention for about the 30 minutes of the birthday party or whatever, and then we're depressed again. See, birthdays can't go on forever. Compliments can't go on forever. So a thrill is not happiness. What we're trying to say is this: knowing only a heavy-hearted way of life, this is my life. Take that away and I'll have nothing. Take away my tears and what will I do with myself? Take away my How many of you get bitter? All of you raise your hand. Over one thing or another. You get cheated, you get bitter. I had a right to that raise, that promotion, whatever. Only knowing complaint. If something comes along and says, I have marvelous news for you, which the great teachers of the ages have done, I have marvelous news for you, all your sorrows can be banished, all your tears will dry up, all your fear of what's going to happen to you tomorrow or 50 years from now, all your tension and anxiety and doubts and confusions and bitterness, all can be taken away from you. All can be dissolved so that you're not living the way you are now living now, which is pretty miserable, whether you admit it or not. Having been faced with the decision that you must give up who you now are, you are a person who, you've been persecuted. Oh, what dreadful things that ex-husband did to you. That ex-wife, and your parents were crazy people. They did the best they could, but they were dreadful people. And what everybody else has done to you, including the government, including religion, everybody has done something to you. What a marvelous feeling of life I can get out of hating anyone who has hurt me. What a marvelous false feeling of life I can get out of being bitter. It always starts with I am lonely. I have been persecuted. I have been left out. I am unloved. I am unliked, etc., etc. It is not the negativity that counts, it is the I that precedes it that is falsely important to us. The I says I, and then we don't care what follows it. We'll find anything, as long as I can keep up the illusion that I am a center of suffering, of persecution, etc., of loneliness. As long as I can feel that I am the center of the drama, that's all that matters to me. Now let's track that back. Why on earth do I want to be the center of my own negative drama, whatever it might be? Why? That's all I know. What else is there? What else is there except suffering me? What else is there except left out me? What else is there but confused me, imposed upon me, uncomfortable me? All the world is very wrongly grateful that the world revolves around each individual. Now, I have just described to you the source of hell. I've just described to you the source of every single... Now you listen, don't you miss this. I have just described to you the source of every single problem you ever have had have now or ever will have, which is the fact that you believe that you exist as a separate person, apart from him, apart from her, apart from me, apart from everyone else in this room. Now, you may not have investigated this far enough to even begin to understand what I'm talking about. So if you're really serious about changing something inside of yourself, then don't you just listen to this talk and then go out and forget it. You'd better take these things home with you and start with the idea. Now, that man sitting up there said that my hell, whatever it is caused by me having a separate identity, having a separate self. Well, let me think about that a little bit. Let's see if it makes sense. I'll tell you what I'll do. Over the next week, I'm going to put this statement to the test. Everything I do, I'm going to turn my attention back on myself and watch my reactions to life as I go out into the world or at home, I'm reading a book, watching the news on television. No matter what happens, I'm going to see if that statement is true, that no matter what happens, I turn it into self-reference. Me, I. You will begin to find that this is a fact, but that's not nearly enough to destroy it yet. It's the beginning of self-observation, of self-awareness, to simply see how we turn everything back on our own false sense of identity. This is happening to me. Let me leap way ahead for a second. If you work on this to the very end, he that endureth unto the end shall be saved, to the very end, you will be able to be in any kind of a situation, whatever, whatever that situation may be, and never get hurt by it, never get touched by it, never have the slightest tear over it. It doesn't mean you're cold, which is what people immediately say when I bring this up. Not cold. In fact, you'll be warm, a warm human being for the first time, because egotism is always very frigid, because all it can think about is itself and its supposed self-interest. You will be able to go through life making $5 a week or $5,000 a week. You'll be able to go through life single, married, divorced, never married, whatever. You'll be able to have lots of friends or no friends, depending on how exterior circumstances happen to come to you. And you're a happy human being, because there is nothing anymore compelling you, nagging you to try to prove that you're okay. You don't have to prove that you're okay, because you know it without even thinking about it, without even trying. So you sit back in life, and instead of becoming a participant in the sense that you need to do something for yourself, you find out that you sit back, just as you're doing pretty much physically here, you sit back and life just flows, because you, the former you, the self-made you, the imaginary you, is not interfering with what happens to you, and therefore there is no conflict. Do you know what our lives consist of? Endlessly, this little ego self leaping into the conversation, leaping into the event, leaping into the news program on television, leaping into it as if I can change it, as if I should do something about it, as if it should affect me in some way at all. And it has no effect on me whatever. Why? Why doesn't this affect me? I'm not there. I've disappeared. There is no self there to be favored or hurt by that exterior event. I'll tell you what to do. You think about some event that has happened to you in the past that hurt you. Let's take hurt. Very simple thing, okay? You think of something that has hurt you in the past. what was it, divorced, you got fired, you got humiliated, you lost something, the business flopped, you lost a friend, on and on. You think of something that hurts you. Go ahead, I'll even give you 2 seconds. Now I'll ask you, to whom did this hurtful event happen? Well, you say it happened to me. Okay, I'll ask you, who are you? Who is the me that this hurtful event happened to? What happened is that this supposed me, this invented self that we've talked a little bit about, jumped into the event and interfered with it because it thought it existed, therefore it thought it should protect itself. You were married for how many years? 15 years? 10 years? 30 years? And then the divorce came along, or the separation. And all of a sudden you felt hurt, you felt bad, you felt you were in a state of shock. You were wondering what your friends would think, you'd wonder what you think about yourself, you wonder where you have failed. And while blaming the other person, of like we always do, you wonder where you might have failed to. Who are you talking about was a failure? Who are you talking about? You see, we will endure the suffering, the burning of hell itself, the hell of having hurt feelings, of having agony. We would rather live in hell than give up the false reward, the false feeling of life that comes out of reacting wrongly to a divorce or a business failure or whatever. Are you following me? Are you following me? How many are not following me? This may be new to some of you. How many are doing nothing at all? I didn't see any hands at all. How many are following me? I'm going to force you to do something. How many are not following me? Well, you're new. You're a student. Come sit down, please. Please don't get up too often and run in and out, huh? I'm going to leap to another subject now, and you will see how it connects with what we've talked about up to this point. We have lots of time for open discussion later, so hold your questions till then. There's a certain subject which we're going to talk about now, connects with what I talked about earlier, which is completely unacceptable to humanity, to society. It is not discussed in polite society, it's not mentioned, it's not examined, it's not dissected at all. Because it is too touchy, it comes too close to home. And we're going to talk about something that Leland mentioned briefly in his introduction. We're going to talk about the subject of lying. Subject of lying. And before we do, whatever you do, now you listen to the caution I'm going to give you, otherwise you're going to slip over into a certain attitude that will be wrong for you, that will be harmful for you. We're going to talk about lying. How many here have ever told a lie? Right. We got that settled. Whatever you do from now on, I want you to not think of lying as a moralistic subject. Get away from the religious condemnation of lying. Get away from anything that has the moral tone to it at all. Otherwise, it will hit this false invented self that we talked about and will distort what you're going to hear. In other words, I want to talk and discuss with you the subject of human lying as simply as a scientific investigation. Simply scientific, nothing, no moral codes about it at all. And it's very simple to do that if you'll start outright. Start by saying, by seeing, that lying is simply a sign of being inwardly divided, of something going wrong inside, so that instead of one whole person operating with his emotions, his physical body, operating with his mind, all in one whole unit, we are divided. One rebel part of us, to simplify it extremely, one rebel part of us is standing apart from the rest of us, wanting to be its own petty god. And that petty god wants its self-will, it knows what it wants and has a right to get what it wants. That apart self will always, always tell lies when it feels itself threatened or when it feels that there's a certain advantage to be gained. And what we're trying to do this afternoon is to see lying not from a moral viewpoint at all, as I said, but simply as a horrible disadvantage to us, simply as one way to remain unhappy. Simply as lying is simply a barrier to being a whole, complete, free human being. Free of what? Free of everything. Free of our own neurosis, then we're free of the world. Then the world's neurosis can't touch us. So we're seeing that lying is a sign of one part of us afraid to let go of itself. You have what? You have a reputation of some kind of being a decent person. You're married. You've never been divorced, and the divorce seems to come up, for example, and you feel, oh, that gives me a label of a divorced person. I guess that's bad. See? Now, what feels threatened? Simply an idea you have had all during your married life that you're a good married person, you're not divorced, you're therefore superior perhaps to people who are, all of which is vanity. So if the divorce is threatened, I'm trying to give you an example. You get your own examples in your own life. So if a divorce seems threatened, then this false part of us has to begin to lie because it feels itself under attack. It has to lie. Oh, that horrible husband of mine, what a terrible man. If you only knew what he did to me, or vice versa. Of course, he might have done that. We're not denying that. But we also know that we are attracted to and live with people who are pretty much, there are exceptions, pretty much on our own psychological level. But that's not the point. Can we simply see lying as something that is harmful to me, a barrier to me finding out who I really am? Because a lie of any kind, I'm talking about psychological lies, deep lies, not little petty lies, although that's included in it too. All lies are an attempt to maintain this false identity apart from God, apart from reality with a capital R, apart from the cosmic whole, capital C, capital W. So every time I lie, for example, I secretly believe that I am smarter than you. I know religion more than you. I know how to run the government more than you. Every time I secretly think I know more than you, which is a vanity thought, I am lying. Because there's no real me here, regardless of the colleges I've gone to, regardless of whether I'm a big high man in the government, there's no real me here at all who can be anything at all labeled. Therefore, this is a lie that I'm smarter than you. And have you ever noticed how very close vanity and lying are concerned? Have you ever noticed how blabbermouthery and lying are concerned? Why am I so anxious? Why do I blab your ear off all day long if I get a chance to tell you about myself? Because I want to try to convince myself that a lie is the truth, and I can blab from now until I die, and I'll never be able to convince myself that my falsehood is true. As we begin to detect this lying that we're talking about, calling ourselves spiritual, that's a good one. Calling ourselves spiritual or religious, giving ourselves a religious label of some kind. As I begin to detect this, the first time or two that I do it, it's going to give me a little bit of a shock. I won't want to see what I know is there. Because then there's something in me that senses that if I see that I'm a liar, then I'll have to give it up. Then there'll be a blank space there, and it's the blank space there that I fear. Because as long as I'm a liar, I know who I am. I know who I am. I'm a liar. Oh, I tell compulsive lies. You watch television, people, incidentally, sometime, and when you get onto this business of lying, you could take a pencil and pad and watch a certain politician or a certain religious leader, and you could put lie one, lie two, lie three, lie four, and you'll run out of paper in just one half-hour talk by them, because you'll be that aware of how other people tell lies because you've gone through your own. You've gone through the shock of seeing how you lie. Look, ordinary conversations. From now on, I'm going to give you something, a very practical work project. Let's see if you do it. I'm giving it to you. Let's see if you do it. Maybe you don't want this. I don't know. That's up to you. From now on, from the minute we start this break, after a while, and during your conversations, during the break with other people, and forevermore for the rest of your life, you're to be very, very alert in your conversations with someone else to detect how in 1 minute, and I didn't say an hour, I said 1 minute, you'll be able to detect perhaps a dozen lies in just 1 minute of conversation to another person. And I've already given you a clue of one of them. Let's see if you remember it. The break comes. Two of you are standing outside and you start talking. And one of you is in a nervous mood, which people generally are, and you want to talk to someone. So you go over and talk to them about almost any subject. And the first word you say is, I. You've already told a lie. If you could say that consciously, that would be another matter, but let's not go into that because you don't know what it means to talk consciously or to say I consciously. Already you've told a lie. For example, you say, oh, I tell you, I'm so very much interested in these things that the man talked about during the talk. I'll tell you, he was talking to me directly. I really want to go into these things. You know what I'll almost guarantee? This is the last talk I'll ever see you at. That's right. I know you're lying. I'll speak bluntly. I'm not talking to any of you directly, though you may be involved. I don't know. I won't give it that much thought. When a person comes up to me after a talk like this or any talk and tell me how interested they are, I secretly say goodbye. I know they're gone. I know they're lying. You see, they don't know it. Why do you have to come up and tell me that these things are so fascinating to you? Why? You're trying to convince yourself that you're someone you are not. Which means if you tell me you're spiritual, I know you're not. Using the word spiritual in the right way right now. How about endless talking? Don't you see the lie in that? Who are you trying to convince? You can't convince yourself. Are you going to try to convince someone else? How about the lie that you have an interesting and productive life? You look into your conversations, husband and wife, friends, and you watch how you drop in a certain little sly hint about how important your life is, what important things you're doing, how exciting it is, and how productive it is. Now I want to tell you something else. 99 9/10 of the things that I have just told you, you didn't hear. You heard the words. But I'll tell you why I know this. I'm not making this up. I'm not being dramatic. The reason I know that 99 9/10 of you did not hear what I said is because I understand your nature very clearly. I even know that you think you understand what I talked about. And indeed, you may have had a brief insight into it, but it's no more than that. I'm telling you this not to insult you, but to try to get you to see the depths of your spiritual sleep. You don't know how asleep you are. You don't know how angry you can get. You don't know how you've made up your mind already. Perhaps some of you right in this room, you have made up your mind that you don't want to hear this kind of stuff anymore. which of course is your choice. You can do anything you want with your life. You can do anything you want with it. So that you can begin this very, very honest self-investigation in order to accomplish something for you. I mean, we're talking personally about every single one of us, myself included. We're talking about doing something that will put an end to the ache. And as long as the lie is there, which will always be unconscious, by the way, and we're trying to make it conscious, which will produce a shock. The lie is unconscious. As long as if I can begin to make the lie conscious, that will begin to put an end to it. Therefore, I will not suffer from the lie anymore. I can begin to do this in very, very small ways at first. For example, how many of you are tricky? You know what I mean by that. You know, tricky, you know. Don't you know that you suffer from being tricky, from trying to get advantages over other people? Why do you want to get an advantage over anyone at all? Because there's a lie involved that says, if I get an advantage, I will feel thrilled, I will feel good, I will feel like an opposite of that person, therefore I exist as someone separate from him. This is nothing more than a lack of conscience. You know, a person who has really found himself has no competition at all, therefore no need to be tricky in any way at all. Don't you know that he's so free inside that he never fawns or begs or chases anyone for anything? And if you ever catch yourself fawning before another human being or chasing them to get something, you stop at once, and your stopping will produce such a jolt in you that you perhaps for the first time be able to consciously detect this inner division, this lie we're talking about, which is the beginning of ending its power over us. That's what we're after. Person can sit here in a room like this, and unless you're determined to go to the very end of this inner investigation, you won't hear a thing, and you therefore you won't change a thing. Let me add an interesting thought I was thinking about on the way out regarding lying. I selected this subject on the way out, and I was thinking I couldn't have used it and wouldn't have used it at another meeting where I spoke this morning, which was a quite a large crowd and a much more formal atmosphere. Let me tell you why. You may find this interesting, and it's part of our general knowledge. If I had given the exact talk this morning at this large place that I'd given here now, first place I wouldn't have, because I understand that you can't. But if I had have, while I was standing there up in the pulpit and looking out at the faces of people, of a large audience, 150 people, perhaps something like that, I would have sensed, detected, and in the air, so to speak, as well as on their faces, I would have detected a very, very definite hostility to what was being said. Because this is I told you at the start, this is a very unappreciated, unacceptable subject. Don't talk to me about lying. Why don't you talk to me about love and kindness and God helping us and our prayers being answered and us getting prosperous and us finally going to heaven and all that? Why do you talk about lying? We should just be spiritual and talk about positive things. So I couldn't do that. And this has to do a good deal with mob psychology. I selected it here because it is more suitable here. I want to talk to you very briefly before we have open discussion, something extremely serious to you. Nothing could be more serious to you than what I'm going to tell you now. You're in a mountain somewhere, and a man who's a good friend of yours says, if you'll dig into the side of this mountain, you'll find a gold mine. It's going to take work. You're going to have to dig. You're going to dig all alone. I'm giving this to you, just to you, because you have to do the work to find the gold yourself. No one else can do it for you. But I'm telling you as a fact, your good friend is telling you, that if you'll get a shovel and a pick, If you'll pitch a tent by the side of the mountain and bring up water and food, completely be self-reliant and on your own. If you will take this shovel and this pick, and if you will dig endlessly day after day, never getting discouraged, if you come to a tremendous boulder, then you use your ingenuity to blast that boulder out of the way. Or if you go for 50 yards inside the mountain after laboring for weeks and you don't see the first trace of gold yet, I want you to keep going. No matter what happens, persist, keep going, because I'm your friend and I'm not lying to you. It would be a dreadful thing for me to lie to you and say there's gold there if there isn't. So I'm telling you that as a fact, your very good friend, that there is gold that you can find if you will do the work, if you will dig inside of that mountain. All right. So your friend says, goodbye, I'm leaving now. And there you are. Now you can make the decision to go get a shovel and a pick and pitch your tent, prepare for your physical needs, and just work day after day, week after month, year after year, if necessary, in order to find the gold. You can make your choice of either one you want to do. So if you take the man's word for it, you will eventually find gold. May take you a long, hard time, and your bones may ache, and you may get discouraged and wonder why you ever started, but you will find the gold. But the important point of the story is this. If you say, I'm not going to investigate for myself whether or not there's gold there, I'm just going to walk away and forget the whole story. It sounds like too much work. It may be fanciful. I'm going to walk away and not discover for myself whether or not there's gold there. When you walk away from there, you will never, never know for the rest of your life what you missed. And I don't care how many times that friend comes back and says, look, if you had just dug there, you would have found gold. You'd become wealthy beyond imagination. The point can be applied to you here. I've told you, no one ever told you anything more serious for your life than what I'm telling you right now and what I'm going to conclude right now. If you go out of this room, and if your conditioning is so hardened, so thick, if you don't want to work, if you just want to daydream, if you just want to go along with the rest of this sick world, then you can perfectly well do that. No one, God Himself, can't force you to go to work. But I am telling you that if you do fall away from this, you will never know what you missed. How could you? How could you know that you missed gold when you didn't see it? And this is the way everybody is. This is the way the world is. Do you know how many people who come to a truth meeting like this ever come back? I don't know what the records are. Leland could probably figure it out, or Rick could figure it out for that matter. The number of people who come to any given meeting and go away not wanting to investigate and work for themselves. I'm trying to prevent you. What chance you have. I'm trying to prevent you from making this mistake, because if you go away and don't persist in studying these truths by coming to meetings like this, reading the books, listening to tapes, you will die when you do die, never, never knowing what you could have had. Now that is a fact. All right, we have just an awful lot of time for open discussion and for questions. Keep your questions short, please. Keep them clear. Don't bring up the name of your favorite book or teacher and ask me what I think about them. But let's here discuss the human problem and the way out, which surely exists. You are on.
To clarify, maybe, or simplify this lying, could it be said that any time I feel inner tension or inner disturbance, agitation, conflict, any of these things is evidence that there's a psychological lie going on.
Yes. Call it a state of lying, even if you don't say anything, right? Yes. State of division, which is a state of lying. We make the mistake of thinking, I start talking about lying, you may think about the time you lied about your age, or lied about the amount of money you make, some of you men maybe. That is really not the kind of a lie we're talking about. It's certainly connected with it. We're talking about a much, much deeper lie than that. The lie about who we are. Because then lying about how much money we make is an outgrowth of that. We're talking about the fundamental lie about who we are and what we're doing here on Earth. And the fact is, the truth is, we are here on Earth to evolve into something higher than we now are. We sense what we now are, confused and petty, childish. How many of you behave childishly? When you do that, when we do that, do we not suffer from it? Isn't that a state of a lie? To behave childishly, to demand your rights, to demand that someone please you the way you demand they please you. It's about time we grew up, and there is a way to do it. Never mind if your wife doesn't want to grow up, if your husband don't want to grow up, your friend, never mind that. If you really sensed the state that you were in, you would drive 100 miles, 200 miles to come to a meeting like this. You'd pay $25 to come to a two-hour meeting if you wanted it badly enough.
Gold suggests something that is going to endure. It suggests something that is going to last perpetually. That's the whole idea. Our lives as they presently are involved in trying to secure and retain trivia. They are things that are absolutely going to go away. If you take it to the final end of the story, if I deny the fact that I, or what presently constitutes this part of the whole thing, is going to die, that is a lie. It is simply going to dissolve. And so, what is going to be left as the real reward of what this is all about? What is my real identity? Is all that I constitute my bank account and my car? And my friends that may leave me tomorrow or desert me if I displease them? Is that all that my true identity amounts to? Well, without answering that question entirely, I'd just like to share something of a personal nature. When you start hacking away at the wall that prevents us from seeing what we really are, it seems interminable. It looks as 20 feet thick, and all we've got to work with is a little hammer, and it's somewhat discouraging. May I comment? As it says in the New Testament, to those that have, it shall be given. And if you stick with what Vernon is talking about, some remarkable things will begin to take place, but they cannot take place in our present condition, our present state of being. When they start to take place, we begin to see, to suspect, that our real identity has something more to do with this. Perhaps we've all seen pictures of the sun, you know, where this tremendous energy, all of this creation is going on and all this light is going out. we begin to suspect that our true identity has more to do with that than with the self that is presently identified with things that are perishing every hour, and that finally at the end of the usefulness of this body are going to utterly perish. Stick with it and some amazing things will happen. That's all I can say.
All right, I am speaking as a new student. I am very anxious that you should describe this new nature to me. Please, I want to know. Would you help me? What's it like?
We have the problem with answering the question that you're now asking is that we have the faculty, the amazing ability to substitute an imagined quality for a reality. If we attempted to describe this new state, you would only want it so badly that your desire would latch on to your imagined condition, and you would begin to say to yourself, ah, that's what I always knew. It's exactly what I've been feeling for such a long time, and now, sir, you've told me that I'm an awakened human being.
Yeah.
And I'm still in my misery. So that's not the way it proceeds. It has to proceed with seeing what is keeping us from it. That incredible wall out there is just what has to be chipped away bit by bit.
Okay.
But the rewards, sir, are very real. Don't be discouraged. You don't need to be.
Okay. You have helped me a good deal.
There's hope for you. The reason we do not see that we are lying is because it's an unconscious thing.
Yes.
And yet, since you equate a state of lying with a state of division,
mm-hmm.
we're in a constant state of lying.
Fine so far? Go on.
That's pretty heavy.
Did you run out of steam, Chuck? Go ahead.
I gotta think about that.
Okay, you think about it. Irene.
To continue that, in other words, everything that comes from the false self or the false personality, which is what we live from, is a lie.
Absolutely.
So we are, as we are now, we are a total lie.
A living, walking, breathing lie.
You told us last night there's nothing we can do about it but see it.
How can a liar stop lying?
He could lie that he stopped lying.
Pardon?
He could lie that he stopped lying.
Yes, yes. Again, watch your friends, watch yourself, and see how we lie so much we no longer know it. We no longer know it. Someday, when I don't want to lose you as friends, when I don't mind losing you as friends, I'm going to stop some of you right in the middle of your talking to me, right in the middle of it, and I'm going to watch the expression on your face, and your expression is going to say, "Oh, I thought you were a nice, kindly teacher. You're mean to me, interrupting me. This is because I have suddenly, very briefly, made you aware of the state you're actually in. But if I did that now, under certain conditions, I know it'd be too much for you. You'd be at what we call the spilling point. That is, you would get so shocked, so unhappy. I know what would happen. You'd stop right in the middle of that blabbermouthery of yours and look at me. Oh, but you'd get over fast, you'd go right back again. But for one second, you would be shocked out of the state you're in. To the degree you can take shocks, to that degree you can shock yourself out of the lying state. if you won't take shocks, if you don't want to come back to a meeting like this, then you have said, I'm going to walk away from that mountain and not have anything to do with that so-called gold in there. If you don't want the shocks to your psychic system, you don't want the gold. You can't have it. You have to get to the point where nothing on God's earth is more valuable to you than finding out what you are all about as a human being here on earth. Nothing is more important than that. Not your friends, not your sex partner, not your money, not your reputation, not your comfortable, smug little life. You're willing to risk all. I said risk, and all your risk is losing your trash. Why don't you risk that as fast as you can? Bill.
Vernon, isn't this a huge joke that contains a great deal of humor, that proud man thinking he is something and is in reality nothing? Isn't there a huge cosmic joke concern in this thing?
No, you mustn't think like that. Simply think that man is mad, God is trying to get through to the madness and succeeds once in a while. Because once in a while, you'll find someone who says, I am not going to live like other human beings live.
Isn't that a trap in itself to say, well, I'm not going to live like this guy, because see, he's a phony who's driving me crazy. I'm not like that. See, I'm
a truth to
nothing.
Yeah. Yes.
You have to shrink back into the basement somewhere. More and more, I guess. This means it takes time.
Yes. I know what you're saying, Grover, and that's quite right. Almost all so-called rebels against society are phonies. They simply are egotists in another way. They would even say, look, you're in the rat race down in the city, I'm going way out in the country and raise my own crops and live in spiritual communion with God and things like that. He's as big a phony as the man in the city, because he's got his images of what it means to be spiritual. That would have to eventually come to an end, wouldn't it? These young kids revolting of a few years ago, talking about love and all that, no one were bigger phonies, and no one was a bigger conformist than they were. They huddled together for their own phony security. Oh, do you understand the character? One characteristic of this egotism, this lying we're talking about, a liar must always surround himself with other people who are telling the same lies he is, so he feels right. See? Isn't that simple? Religious people of this denomination or of that denomination, they must find other people who are lying the same lies that they are, or they begin to feel nervous. Now they feel, quote mark, comfortable with each other. You try to drag them away from that and watch how they hate you. You're taking away their, quote mark, security. Yes, Bill.
I wanted to explore this humor a little bit, because, you know, one can take oneself too seriously. I mean, this pack of lies or this invented self can be taken. Now, to put it in a lighter vein, you know, so you can look at it objectively, doesn't a certain amount of humor enter into that he can laugh at himself?
Yes, the time will come when you'll laugh at what a little idiot you were, thinking you were so nice and wonderful. Sure.
That's
a certain form, definite form of shock, by the way, a healthy shock. Have you ever done that? How many of you were ever 18 years old? How many were ever 18? All right. When you were 18, remember how smart you were, huh? Remember how you knew more than anybody in the world, huh? And remember you took that 18-year-old mentality out in the world and it got hurt, huh? Now that you're 30, 40, or older, don't we see what little idiots we were at 18? The very same thing. People who call themselves spiritual, who think they understand truth and all that, they are going to have to go through the humiliation and eventually the big laugh at what a big idiot they were, thinking that they knew so much. And man, they could quote you every book, every esoteric book, they could quote the Bible. They knew everything. What he was, what she was a walking, talking parrot. A parrot doesn't want to be told he's a parrot, does he? And he can talk about consciousness. He can talk about anything. He can do everything but live it. And one way to avoid having people finding out that you're not living it is, again, to ally yourself in a group of other people who are performing the same hypocrisies that you are, because then there's the silent agreement. We have a strict agreement not to tell each other that we're telling lies. If you don't call me a liar, I won't call you a liar. Now we're safe. Now we're sunk, really, but they don't know that.
Last night, you had a man who said that it seemed too mundane to live like this, and of course you answered it. Would you explore something? The excitements that sustain these lies.
Oh, yeah, sure. Take a look at yourself. You have to do this yourself. Anytime you ask a question like that, you have to do the work if I just tell you. What gives you a thrill? What gives you an excitement? It will be what you call the opposite of a present negative state of yours. If you were lonely and the phone rings and that handsome, charming TV actor phones you and says, "Dear lady, how about a date tonight?" You'd get pretty excited, right? If he's your type. You get excited because you're lonely, and that seems to offer an escape from loneliness. You're going out to nice dinner, and you're going dancing, and have a good time. That is a phony excitement. For one thing, it's something happening outside of yourself. You're using some outside agency in order to make you feel like something. The very fact that you want someone to try to make you feel unlonely, that's the lie. See the lie in that? That man, when he phones me and invites me out for the date, and I want to be sure to tell him all my girlfriends, but they'll be jealous. Now you've got a little extra, right? A little bonus to them. The very fact that you think that someone else from the outside can give you something is a lie, and the heartache will always follow. It must follow, because even while we're getting the thrill, we know that it's a temporary movement, and we'll have to go back to the depression tomorrow night. And not only that, but you'd be so anxious to please him, so anxious to please her. You'd be nervous, and you won't know how to talk. That's no way to live. Let me tell you something. Try to understand what I'm saying now, please. You be completely independent of every other human being on earth, not in withdrawal, not in egotism, not in fear, but because you are so whole in yourself, so understanding of what life is all about, that you're not depending on them to make you feel anything at all. You already have a state of being that is 10 million miles higher than any feeling of excitement that you might get. And that state of being then legitimately can have relationship with anyone that is right without you fawning or hoping. Don't you dare hope for anything from anyone. Never. You don't have to. You don't have to be a coward. You don't have to be. I'm telling you, you don't. And the way to find out for yourself is to do it. You start cutting yourself free from other people. And if you make a lot of mistakes, if you do as Grover suggested, you think that being free goes out means going out and being a hermit or something. All right, so you've made that mistake. Correct it as soon as you can. We're all going to make 1,000 mistakes. Never mind the mistakes. Just start to do it. Okay. Yes, Sarah.
Vernon, what you just said was the most wonderful news. We just think about it. Because we live our lives completely at the mercy of all the events in life, and the way our self-centered little attitudes are, the way we interpret every event, and we're just totally pathetic.
Yes. Go beyond the opposites of ever, ever again asking one of two questions. Never again ask either of these questions. How can that person or event harm me? How can that person or event favor me? Drop both completely and forever. Then you will have a right relationship with that man, with that woman, with that friend, with that relative, with that stranger, with that boss, whether or not they are right inwardly or not. Their negativity, their egotism, their sickness has nothing to do with you. You have a right relationship with every human being on earth, with every event on earth, because you have a right relationship with yourself. Wouldn't that be a marvelous way to live? So you wives don't look at your husband's face to see whether he's in a good or bad mood, and you hope that he's in a good mood so he won't make that sarcastic remark. For God's sake, woman, why do you think you're on earth? Not to please that man, but to set yourself free from yourself, not even from him. We had better find out why we are here. You find that out by finding out why you are not here, and you're not here to please any sick human being. Yes?
What is spirituality?
First of all, it's a word, isn't it? And if we use the word consciously instead of personally, egotistically, then we'll understand. We can use the word spiritual. I think perhaps we've used it today sometime. What we want to avoid is to avoid using it unconsciously, therefore identifying with the word, saying that I am spiritual, or that man is spiritual, I'll follow him. How do you know he's spiritual? What are you talking about? Why don't you find out what it really means to be spiritual, and you'll find that out when you drop all associations connected with the word spiritual. Alan.
Is lie and loss of energy, they go together, don't they? Sort of a vicious circle.
The lying and lots of energy.
Loss
of energy. Indeed, yes. We're wasting energy in lies, are we not? By the way, to take off from that just a little, if I may. Have you ever noticed the incredible, unbelievable, almost energy in neurosis? Haven't you ever seen the fierce drive of a super sickie? Huh? Look at all that wasted energy that they could spend in becoming healthy.
Actually, what it is, the division is where two things are fighting against each other. So all of the energy of the system is going into that particular battle, which means there's nothing left.
Yes, right.
Or nothing left of consequence, anyway.
I'll illustrate it. Leland just reminded me. One second, please, and then you can go on. There was a big inventors convention, and all the inventors brought their little boxes and machines and gadgets, some to hoe corn and others to measure the stars, you know, all kind of inventions. And one man had an invention of a box like that, and he set it on the table, and he turned it on, and the wheels started turning, and the lights went on and off, and went made all kind of noises, and man, it really looked impressive. So someone asked him, what does your machine do? And he says, nothing. It's a nothing machine. It just moves and makes, turns on, lights go on and off, and power is consumed. It doesn't do a thing. Does that describe some of us? Nothing machines. We're not doing anything constructively. We're just churning wheels and wasting energy.
when we quit trying to please others, they get angry and go away.
Sometimes.
Or
fawn before
or
you.
Or fawn back.
Yes.
Okay. When we quit trying to please the wrong parts of ourselves,
they get mad.
They get angry.
Mm-hmm. And threaten you.
Right. And they are either going to leave, but now they also will fawn too.
Yes.
And pretend.
I should say. Boy, I'll tell you. Try to see the difference between decent intelligence and cunning intelligence. You know what I mean, I'm sure. Cunning intelligence is of the devil. People in power, political, religious, social, any kind of power at all, are cunning devils. Christ was an intelligent human being. Buddha was an intelligent human being. Politicians, religionists, are cunning devils. Well, I'll tell you, you want a difficult but valuable task? Find out that you're nothing at all. Boy, will that be a shock. You are fighting, Bill, like mad, not to see that Bill doesn't exist.
It's all unconscious.
Oh, yes.
All unconscious.
Yes. Even though we're talking about it, it's still unconscious.
Right.
Yeah. It's all right. It's all right. Little by little, we can begin to see the trick that we're playing on ourselves and that we're suffering from. That's our hope, real hope. That I can come to a meeting like this, we can talk about these things, and begin to talk with true intelligence about these little hoaxes that we've been under that we didn't know we were under. We actually believed, and maybe still believe, that when someone says something mean to me, I have to get mad. We actually believe. You don't think so. How many of you got mad today? Well, you can admit it. We know it anyway. Last week, how many got mad?
Got mad at the motorcycle guy out here for making a lot of dust.
Okay. Go ahead, Bob.
Are you working harder at this meeting this afternoon than the one that you worked at this morning?
I'm working different, Bob. Yes. I'm working both places, but I was working different there in a different way because the audience was different. Remember I explained a little bit about it?
If I see one of these lies, if I see the contradiction, does the shock of awareness convert the energy loss into something useful?
Yes.
We are so totally consumed in living our lives that there's no energy, no nothing left for life, it seems to me.
For real life,
yeah.
For a life that's natural. Think of the word natural for a minute. Or better yet, think of the word unnatural. How about unnatural manners in front of other people? You know what I mean? You know what I mean? Are you unnatural in manners before certain people? Because you want benefits from them, or if it's a policeman, you don't want him to give you a ticket or whatever. Do you know what we can start doing? Whatever circumstance we find ourselves, with relatives, anyone, we can start to be conscious in that situation, which is the same thing as being natural. Then you would have a natural flexibility because there would be awareness behind the various ways you would talk to different people. I talk to a number of you people here in this room in a different way. You talk to different people in a different way. If you're doing it consciously, then there's no division.
In the state that this is, that I am, the only consciousness that I can be aware of is to try and pay attention to what I'm saying and catch my feelings at the same time and see if I'm trying to manipulate or con or, and just, that would be a kind of conscience to be aware of that?
Yes, that's a good start. Certainly a good start. Yes, sir.
Going back to Chuck's comment about energy, I sense that this work takes tremendous energy to do, to watch all the time what you're doing, what's going on here. It just takes tremendous energy. But I'm also finding that the energy dissipates very quickly if I go into daydreaming or just some kind of negative reaction to something that I'm not being aware of. It just drains away.
All right. How many of you have had wandering minds during this meeting anytime? Wandering minds. How many of you have been gone 50% of the time? Shall I go on 80%?
Why?
That's a good example of what Sarah was pointing out. We're gone somewhere else. Then a second bomb. You have to get the point where you want this, and you're not going to let anything stop you. You don't care what boulders are in front of that gold. You don't care about that. You don't care how your hands get tired and your brain gets weary, or your arms can hardly pick up the axe. Here's what to do. When you get tired of swinging the axe, when you want to quit, force yourself to do it again. You're about ready to lay the axe. What do you hit a hammer, a mountain with?
Sledgehammer.
No!
Pick!
Pickaxe. Pick. This is a man who hits a mountain with a sledgehammer.
He's got big mountains.
When your arm can't pick up the pick anymore to hit the wall, to hit the mountain again, and you want to collapse and give up, I order you to pick it up again and work for 5 minutes more. That will force you to use more energy than you have, which will create more energy. And you can do that right here in this room. No matter how hard you've been working, assuming you're working at all, how hard you're working, you say to yourself, I'm going to do a number of things to hit that mountain again and get it faster at that goal. I'm going to change my physical position. I'm going to let my fingers go limp like this. Here I'm going to let my shoulders go and let my jaw go limp. I'm going to sit here physically relaxed. And then I'm going to sit here and pay very careful attention to not only the man up there in the front, but when this man asks a question, this man asks a comment. I'm going to just see what my reaction is to everything, and I'm not going to judge everything. And I'm going to sustain that as long as I can. You'll get tired and you'll wander off to something else, but bring yourself back as soon as you can. That's the secret. Try to be aware that you're wandering. And one success breeds the next success, right? You see that you can do it. You see that you can sit here and relax and just take everything in. And you're aware that you're a little stronger than you were perhaps 10 minutes ago, an hour ago, or whatever. Confidence comes by seeing. Real confidence comes by seeing. Yeah. You don't care how someone's going to treat you, for example. What do you care? If you do care, who cares? What entity inside of you is anxious over how someone's going to treat you? What anxiety in you is thinking, I hope he treats me good, but maybe he'll treat me bad? Why are you thinking about that at all? Why are you the slave to that person? Or better yet, why are you the slave to that anxious thought? Get rid of it. Then he or she can treat you any way he wants. And what's the problem to you? How many of you have trouble sleeping nights? Any of you have trouble sleeping? All right, then I repeat the advice, and it's a little deeper than the words. don't give two hoots whether you go to sleep or not.
The false self wants to join groups, wants specific people's approval, to please them so they approve in return. It's constantly busy inside here doing all this to protect itself so it can stand. Because without this, it cannot stand alone. Is
exactly,
that right?
Exactly. Write down a sentence if you're a writer downer. You inspired it, Irene. Neurosis never rests. Neurosis never rests. You understand that, don't you? How we have to keep driving to convince ourselves that the piece of, a hunk of gravel we have is nuggets of gold. There's no way you can convince yourself of it because it's a lie. I have a handful of gravel in my hand and I say, this isn't gravel, it's gold. Boy, am I going to have to work hard to convince myself of that. And if I can find people who are deluded where I am deluded, I'll go over to Leland and I'll say, Leland, isn't this marvelous gold? And Leland, being deluded, will agree with me. This is the secret of the so-called cohesion and unity of religious groups. They're about as united as leaves scattered by the wind. They're brought together only by personal self-interest. Everyone in that religious, governmental, social, any organization come together because of secret self-interest, which always masquerades itself as something noble. Pressure groups of any kind at all, members of any pressure group, will always come together saying they're doing it for the good of the people. What they want is more dough. You know, it's very easy, not just Bill, but anyone. It's very easy to ask all kind of complex questions. That's easy to do. You can talk with your mechanical mouth, with your mechanical thoughts. Why not, instead of doing something mechanical, why don't you refuse to go along with it and sit back and relax and watch the little bit of tension you have inside of you over the fact that you've thrown a log in front of the truck of your mechanical desire to ask a question as part of your self-work here. And watch the little disturbance you have created in yourself because you have forced yourself not to ask the question. There is observation of yourself. We have another 10 minutes or so, if you'd like to go on. Yes, Chuck.
Leland was right. That was a bombshell regarding the lies, the truth about lies. And I find that truth so fascinating or something that it seems like everything else that's been discussed since then is superfluous. I can't understand how I'm feeling.
All right, just a comment on that, Chuck. Get yourself to the point where you can never really go back to the world again. How many understand what that means? All right, let's see. Sarah, comment, explain.
We have to get to the point where we can see through the world, see through all the little setups, all the little games, all the competition, ambition, so forth. So we know there's nothing there. We can't go to that.
Look, who wants to go back to the lunatic asylum? We've lived in it long enough. I'm not going back. You going back? You make up your mind you're not going back. Don't you let anyone drag you back with promises of good things either. A lunatic can only give you lunatic-y things. And you had better better develop your observation, your insight, so that you know a lunatic when you see one. A lunatic is any unconscious human being. Right, Rick? I saw you reacting. Go ahead, Sarah.
I wanted to add, lunatics talk all the time about love when they're full of hatred.
Lunatics talk all the time about love and they're full of hatred, and they talk about sanity. Psychiatrists who are lunatics, most of them, 99 percent, there may be one or two, and I have read a couple of books in the past of one who is on the way at least. Lunatic psychiatrists talk about sanity at $50 an hour. Look, please go out of here and start exhausting yourself in this inner work. Don't hold back your strength. Don't hold back your energy. What are you saving it for? I've got good news. The more you spend, the more you get. Now you're going to hesitate to do that because you're afraid you're going to exhaust your energy. My dear man, my dear lady, without exaggeration and without being dramatic, you have the energy of the entire universe in back of you. You can't drain that. But egotism is quite sure that energy is limited because it knows, it senses that it is limited, isn't it? It is limited, it wants to control the world, it can't even control itself. And so it limits energy. When you understand, when you get onto these things, you'll make every effort you can to pick up that pickaxe when you're dead tired and everything screams into you, don't, no more work, you've worked hard enough, go have a drink, cold drink. No, you defy that and you force yourself more energy. You watch. One day you'll be able to pick at the mountain for 15 minutes before you really drop where it would affect your physical health, and that has to be considered too. Next day you'll be able to work for a half hour, the next day for a full hour, because you're going against your own natural inertia and laziness. Till the time comes, this is true, what I'm going to tell you is true, you can work 24 hours a day on yourself. You can remember your successes. Try, and you will, and that's power. The first time you're sitting and watching television and you see some bad news. What isn't bad news? You know, that's what makes news bad news. One man started a happiness paper, nobody bought it. People like bad news because it's most like their own nature, you see. You're watching something on television and you see something that's bad news to your pocketbook or whatever. Maybe for the first time you became aware of this feeling of dread that went through you when you saw that news announcer give the bad news, whatever it was. For the first time you saw, because your attention is not only on that TV screen, but your reactions to it, and you actually saw for the first time your reaction to it, your of gloom, of depression, whatever it might be. Do you know what you're doing? You're beginning the very start, believe me, it's a lot farther than this, but this is a marvelous start. You're beginning to disidentify with your own feelings, your own negativities. This is the beginning to free yourself of them. Look, we sat and watched television all these years and heard all this bad news and felt depressed. We didn't even know the cause of it. The cause was we identified with what that man said on there, which means we're a slave to anybody who can say anything to us. We're beginning to recover our real nature, which is not negative. God can't be negative, please. Truth can't be negative. We're beginning in a small way, of course, for us to live from that. That can never get depressed or morose over what that news commentator says. you will remember that success. The next time you watch the TV news, you'll be a little more energetic, right? A little more alert. So the next bad news, you're watching this go through you, you don't identify with it. That is, you don't get a sense of identity. That news is going to hurt me because you now are beginning to understand who you are not. And you are not that feeling of gloom that went through you. You are the kingdom of heaven within, which has no gloom at all. A couple more questions, then we'll stop for the day. Well, so again, I'll ask you, in this session here, you've been given many, many things to take home with you. Some of you may persist in it. Some of you may not, which proves that in spite of you coming to a group like this and hearing the truth, I know you've heard the truth here today and you sense it. In spite of all that, the darkness of this world is so powerful, so overwhelming, that you won't want to come back to another meeting like this or persist in reading the books or listening to the tapes. You will not want to do it. And the whole thing is so simple. It's because you have gone so far in darkness that you prefer to live in that and not make any effort to begin to pick up the pick. You have to do something besides being a lazy, smug human being. And if you want to remain a lazy, smug, miserable, unconscious human being, then you can do that. I am telling you, as part of my duty, I am telling you that you're going to have to arouse yourself, or you're going to have to live and die in your present state of unawareness and unconscious misery. You have been given a chance today. Don't throw it away. If you throw it away, I told you earlier, if you toss it away, you will not know what you tossed it away. If you think for 1 second that when you came to this meeting today, that you just came to an ordinary religious meeting, philosophical study, or whatever, you're making the mistake of your life. I'm trying to be very emphatic about this, because maybe, just maybe, in the case of some of you, it could penetrate that you have been, as Leland phrases it sometimes, in a very, very extraordinary place, hearing very extraordinary things that the masses of human beings don't want. You find out what's going on inside of you, and if you see any parts of you that won't want this, you become aware of that. And don't you dare go along with them, because they are stealing your eternity. Good afternoon.